What's up? Welcome to day 270, Making Songbringer. And I'm working on drawing a tree today. We call this the mother tree. Might be something special. It might just look pretty. I'm sure there'll be some secret. And then I'm also working on patterns. So the overworld is, we've got all these new patterns for the overworld, and I got a couple new ones called, there's these rows right here. Nice, third try it works. It was never the fault of your code? Oh. Oh man. Crazy dude. Oh, congratulations for getting that working. That's awesome. I like that one. Be some dots. Well, yeah, I'll work on those in a minute. I want to start with the mother tree first. Art time. Yay. So I got the bottom part of this tree started. I'm gonna finish the top of the tree. It's the bare branches of it and also the not so bare branches of it. Let's do that right now. Let's do this. What's up, JFK? How you doing, man? Okay, so I'm gonna do a new layer. Some leaves and stuff. Might be a little too full. Nice, Pedro. Nice, right on, JFK. You got a job. Yeah, right on, dude. I'm doing good. Yeah, things are great. You know, it's like gearing up to be Christmas time here, holidays time here. So, you know, lots of good cheer. We just put up our tree and all that. Okay, I don't think I'm gonna try this again. Is this Ori? No. I don't know if this is actually a mother tree. I just wanted to draw a big tree, and mother tree is kind of a fun word. But yeah, it's totally Ori, right? Trying to get the outline done for this, and then I'll go and do the details. Oh, whoops, I drew all that on the wrong layer. think in general, this might be a bit too big. The top of this tree might be too big, a little. What's up, Kofez? Welcome to the stream, man. I'm here drawing a tree, a big tree. This is gonna be kind of a point of interest. Ah, see, that's what it needed, a little bit of, yeah. A little bit of that. It's nice. Just that tiny adjustment right there. When I use libraries that compress, decompress, zlib. Kofez, this is something that's totally up to you and your game, or maybe the engine you're working with. I don't particularly use a zip file or whatever. So, but I think you're asking if you would use a zip file, what happens? But typically on it, this works this way on Android. Android, all the AFK files. Hello, Seb Sub, by the way. On Android, all of your any file that runs an app on Android is called an AFK file. It's .afk, which is technically just a zip file. So on Android, what happens is when you load your app, it actually reads the zip file, uncompresses the contents of it. I'm not sure how it works exactly. I'm not sure if it uncompresses the whole thing into memory and then recompresses it after it's done. I'm not sure exactly. So you would have to look that up. You'd have to go do some research on Android, figure out how that works on that platform. And as far as your question in general, it's kind of hard to answer that in general because it totally depends on your game engine, whether it uses a zip file or whatever. Mine doesn't. Mine just uses a completely free and clear text files and image files, and everything is free and clear, so it's easy to mod the game. But yeah, so it totally depends on your implementation. So you could do it any one of the ways you just asked. You could do it that way. You could uncompress the contents, read it into memory, then write it again later when you're done. Or maybe you count your zip file as totally read only. You only unzip it and then read it to content, something like that. Flugurion, don't tell my father I'm watching this. Does he not like trees? Or does he hate game development? Oh, Seb Sub, yeah, I know I've been programming for 20 years, but I've only been making art for a few years. I've only been making music for a few years too, so you can do it. It takes time, sure, to learn how to do all this stuff, but with today's tools, it's a lot easier to make games, dude. You can make games so much quicker, and the tools today are so much better. So it's easier now than it's ever been to be a game developer. But yet, even though I say that, it is still a very difficult thing to be a game developer. It takes a hell of a lot of time and a lot of determination to make video games. And you may think I'm exaggerating there, but I'm not. It takes so much time and so much determination to finish a video game. That's why most people never do it. So, if you're somebody that goes and actually finishes a video game, you're well ahead of the pack already. All right, Kofez. Yeah, so you just might want to do your own research on that and kind of just choose how you would want to do your zip. If you're going to use zip files, how you would use them. It's kind of up to you. All right. Doesn't like games. Okay, I won't tell him, I promise. I won't tell if you won't tell. So today I'm drawing a big tree. This is what I'm working on. This big tree is going to be a little an element in this game. It's I'm not sure if it's going to be a secret or not. It probably will be some sort of secret involved with this. And then once I get this done, I'm going to work on some more patterns for the overworld. These are like gonna be pretty Zelda 1 inspired patterns. So happy Sunday to everybody watching the stream. Pretty sure it's still Sunday for most people. Nice, you've been programming in C sharp for a year. Unity 3, Mono, X and A. You always wanted to develop in C++. So, okay, yeah, I have plenty of tips. I would love to give you some tips. First of all, let's qualify what tips to give. Thanks, Sebso. I'm glad you think it's an inspiration. I'm using a stylus, Steve Mata. C++ tips. First of all, why have you always wanted to learn C++? Why aren't you happy? Or maybe you are happy, but I mean, what? Why? If you're already familiar with Unity, why would you ever switch to C++? Unity is an awesome engine. So what is it that's really calling you or making you want to learn C++? So that help me help answer that question, and I can help you answer your other question there a lot better. So first up, what I'm doing is I'm blocking in this overall shape for this tree. And then I'm going back in and adding details. You notice that I blocked in the bottom and then just added all the details. It's like, yeah, I gotta do something here. But yeah, for now, so now I'm just going in and blocking in the overall shapes, and then details will come secondary. And yes, I definitely prefer using a stylus for making pixel art, or making any kind of art. First of all, it feels a lot more natural because it feels like a pen. And I'm using a graphics tablet. I'm using a Bamboo, which is just a really cheap graphics tablet. But yeah, I've used the mouse occasionally to make pixel art, and it's really, I find it to be very, very clunky. Using a mouse is very slow, very clunky, in my opinion. You know, you can get by making pixel art with a mouse, but I don't recommend it. Yeah, it's the $100. It's like an $80 style one called the Bamboo. They don't think they make this version anymore. They've got a newer, upgraded, better version. But yeah, this is it. It's like a bamboo. It's just a very simple, small thing, you know, and it's got absolute positioning. So if I move my cursor to any corner, it automatically moves the mouse point or whatever to instantly that point. Thing is, Unity, it all has done written code and such. Huh? Feels like I'm just using stuff like building blocks to make a game work. It may sound strange, but I want to learn to make games from the ground up. Ah, okay. You want to write your own graphics. Ah, okay. And maybe someday make your own game engine. Okay, well, cool. That definitely clarifies it. So, okay, you're looking for tips on how to start C++ because you really want to make games from the ground up. You want to learn to make your own engines and stuff. That's great, dude. Good for you. I would recommend starting with C. Don't even start with C++. And what's great about C is that you can still do OpenGL. So check out, so, like, I got a starter thing that might help you actually on GitHub. My GitHub is NatWeese. So here's where go here, and then I have a, what is it called? A GLFW test, I think. FW test, is that right? Yeah, here we go. This is GLFW is a cross-platform library which gets you started with OpenGL. So if you can get your project running with GLFW, you essentially have the platform to develop an OpenGL game on Mac, Linux, and Windows. So GLFW is pretty rad. So I would recommend starting with something like this, GLFW. Basically, this just helps you get your Windows set up and OpenGL set up. And from then on, it's your responsibility to handle your OpenGL however you want. So if you really want to learn to make games from the ground up, I would say learn OpenGL and learn C first. So start with C, and I would start with learn C the hard way. Here's learncodethehardway.org. They got a few free books, and one of them is for C. So I would start with C, and then learn all that, learn it really well. And then learn C++ on top of that. Because learning C will just teach you all the basics and everything. Pointers, all the basic math. And C was the precursor to C++. C was also kind of the, you know, C++ was kind of the inspiration for C sharp. So it all kind of goes back to C. So when you learn C, you're going to kind of learn almost everything else in a way. So that's what I recommend doing, man. Hey, what's up, Caviar? Sorry, I know that's not how you say your name, but that's the only way I say your name. Okay, so back to this tree. I'm blocking in the shape of this tree before I do its details of these branches. Yeah. So, if you haven't seen this game too, let me show you the game really quick that I'm working on. It's called Songbringer. I've been working on this over a year now. It was successfully funded on Kickstarter. It's already on Steam. Not for sale on Steam, but the game is up there on Steam, so you can wish list it and stuff. Basically, it's a game a lot like Zelda 1. You've got items. You got lots of different items you can use. This is the secret item that shows you secret paths and stuff. You get psychedelic powers. You can throw your top hat. You got lots of other items and stuff you can use in this game. Right? What's harder, to learn programming or pixel art drawing? Good question. I don't know. I would say programming's harder, but That's just me. I guess it totally depends on you, you know, on what you think and stuff. What's your opinion? What's easy for you? What's not easy for you? You know, how is your brain wired? That's gonna kind of determine what's easier for you. Cool, right on. Thanks, Steve. Flood, I do the sound, I do the music, I do the pixel art, I do everything. I even do the business for this game, which, you know, some people don't consider, they don't consider how important business is to making indie games, but business is huge. So you got to do, if you're an indie, you really kind of got to learn how to do your own marketing, you know, how to do your own social media, how to manage your own community and stuff like that. That stuff's really, really important. All right, this tree's starting to shape up, man. Right? Yeah, see? It totally depends, right? Some people would say pixel art's hard. Some people say sound, music is hard. Some people say programming's hard. I'm a real proponent of being at least a little bit good in all of those areas. I really, really respect anyone who makes in a game entirely themselves. You know, you make all the art, make all the music, all the sound. One of my indie game heroes is Thomas Happ, who made Axiom Verge. He did all the music, all the sound, all the art for that game, and I think that's awesome. So I think it's really cool to, if you're starting out in game development, or you're any phase of you are in game development, doesn't matter, to learn kind of a little bit of all those things. Learn a little bit of how to make art, whatever kind of style you're into. Learn a little bit about making music. Learn a little bit about programming and a little bit about game design, a little bit about music. Get kind of good at all those things, and you start to become a real powerful creator. You can create anything you want, you know. What's up, Arcane? What's this gonna be for? This is just gonna be some art for the overworld. I'm not sure if this, I think this will be some sort of secret, but yeah, it's just so far, it's just gonna be a piece of art. It would be cool if it was a final boss, though. Thanks, Seb Sub. What's up, Paradise? Nuclear, what's up? Bedroom Game Devs, that's me. This is kind of a bedroom in here. Bedroom Game Devs. Cool name. I like that. Yeah, this is all starting to look better. Cool. Yay. Just getting these branches to look more branchy, less piled up, more like, you know, tapering. Tapering is a good word for these taper. Taper it up, man. Sergeant Sam, oh my God, great question here. You've always wondered, how can you pay your bills as a long time? Oh, how can you pay your bills as a longtime indie dev? You don't think Kickstarter can finance everything? Actually, it can. It totally can. If you ask for enough on Kickstarter, and if you've built up enough following, on Kickstarter, you can totally fund your entire game. Look at Doko Roko. It's another solo guy. He just got like 60 grand for his game. You have to be bold. You have to, I think one of the things that really helps on Kickstarter also is if you have really great concept art, really great art helps a lot. Look at this. Oh, 40 grand. Anyways, 40 grand. He said, okay, I need 2 years to make it. One of the mistakes I made during in my Kickstarter was that I underestimated how long this game would take. I thought I could finish it in 6 months, but really it was more like a 2 year game. So I'm currently trying to find ways to alpha fund the game or, get more funding so I can keep going and keep making more of this game. But this is, I think Doko Roko is a great example of a Kickstarter project where he asked for what he needed. He's like, okay, I need 2 years worth of funds. And he found more than that. So, anyways, in answer to your question, yes, you can find the funds on Kickstarter, or possibly you can find the game for funds from a publisher. And in fact, if you've done a successful Kickstarter, you're going to be approached by several publishers. I was approached by the guys that make what are they called? Shoot, what's it starts with a D. They're a publishing company. And they're publishing Rain World. No, Adult Swim contacted me, but anyways, it doesn't matter. But the point is, you gotta find a way to pay your bills at first. If you can fund your game development by doing other stuff, like for a while when I was making this game and starting out making it, the first 4 months I was funding the game through my savings and stuff like that. I don't recommend doing that, but I was also doing some web work, right? So I kind of had a day job almost, which was more like a night job. But anyways, the point is, find some way to fund your game until you can do a Kickstarter, and then just kick ass. Do a Kickstarter, hope that it succeeds. If it doesn't succeed, it's a probably a sign that your game design or your game in general or something just needs tweaking. You can try again. But I did put all of my marketing advice on everything on a Gama Sutra article. Let's see if that is that the link right there, Gama Sutra. Looks like Bafu's not here today. Oh well. But if you look for my name, Nathaniel Weiss, on Gama Sutra, I did write an article about all that. Paradise, you're using Entity Foo? Cool, man. You understand how it works, but you don't see how to make a complete game with it? Oh, Paradise, man, this is a question I can't really answer for you easily. This is something you have to kind of answer yourself. I would start with a health component. And in fact, Paradise, if you want to go look at my old YouTube videos, if you go to my YouTube channel, there's a link there on the on my stream information. Go look at like some of my first videos, and I was developing the ECS for this game, and all I had was a health component. So check that out. Start with the health component. Just make it so it ticks down an entity's health. Start with the simplest, basicest things you can. And I know right now, maybe it might seem overwhelming. It's like, oh my God, how do I make a game with an ECS? But, I'll tell you, I felt the exact same way when I started this game. I was like, I don't really know how to make a game with ECS. And oh my God, there's too many components to even think about creating right now. And you can totally get yourself overwhelmed that way. But start small, start with simple stuff. And it will get easier. Nuclear, am I marketing my game yet? Hell yes. Yes, I am releasing alpha versions. Yes, Nuclear. There's like I just said, it's the game's already on Steam. It's already had several alpha releases. It's had a preview release. It's got attention from the press already. It's got a successful Kickstarter. So hell yes, I'm marketing it daily. It's on IndieDB, it's on Twitter, Tumblr. Take source, all the T social networks. Pedro. Oh, whoa. Did you turn it into a C sharp or a Unity tracer? Oh, thanks, clock. Thank you. Yeah, thanks. Thanks for posting that link. That's the one. The Gama Sutra article. Yeah, oh man, this is really starting to shape up. This tree's looking good. Just gotta make taper these branches. That's the word, man. Taper. Taper these things and it starts looking good. In fact, I don't even know what this... What is this branch? What is this branch doing? What's up, Scottish Pizza? You've been working on a game in Unity? Do I have any advice? Yes, I do. Nice, you wrote a binder for Unity? That's cool, Pedro. Pedro's working on a blender, not a blender, but a renderer. Yes, Scottish Pizza. Here's my advice. Go check out Extra Credits videos on game design and game development. My biggest piece of advice is to follow your heart, but my second biggest piece of advice is the Extra Credits videos. Let me post this link for you, to Extra Credits. Oh, you know what? I can't really post links with this, but, check out Extra Credits Game Design YouTube playlist. Yeah, here it is, totally. So type this into Google. Check this out. Start watching these videos, Scottish Pizza, on a daily basis, I would say, as you're learning your game development. You know, keep playing with Unity, master Unity, get great at Unity, because Unity is awesome. But check out these videos. These are amazing. These are incredible lessons on game making games, every one of them. And they're all in short little bits. And just check them all out, man. Watch every one of these videos. It will be some of the best education on game development you can get. And my second piece of advice on game development is to follow your heart. Literally and strongly. SebSub. So learning C or programming C overall is a pain if you're on Windows? No, it's not. It's definitely not a pain on Windows. Just get Visual Studio. Visual Studio supports C, C++, all those. It's not a pain at all. Ray Tracer, right? I was calling it a renderer. Oh, thanks, Clock. Thank you. Once again. Okay, this tree is almost done. Let's see. There's this one branch that's kind of weird. It's connecting itself in a weird way. I'm thinking this one is going to be kind of a small branch. It's behind everything. Other than that, I like this. Maybe this bit here. Yeah, that's better. All right, cool. Time to add some details. Wait, no, this branch right here. Taper. Taper is the key word of today. Is it a magic word? Say, what's that show where there was a magic word? Was it Mr. Rogers? An IDE will turn you stupid. They're the worst tools if you want to be a good programmer because they hide what's going on from you. And your job is to know what's going on. Well, in some ways, I guess they're right. In some ways, I guess they're wrong. I use an IDE all the time. You know, this is like a tool that, you know, I couldn't live without an IDE. It has an integrated debugger and everything. But in a sense, they're right in that if you really want to learn how to make game engines and everything, you really do need to know exactly what's going on. So I think you should at least have the experience of working a little bit without an IDE. So that means write some code in C, compile it on the command line, run it from the command line. That should definitely be something that you've done, right? At least let's say you've at least done that for a day, right? Go at least use a compiler for a day and don't use an IDE. But I'd say in general, you really do need to use IDEs. Maybe you don't need to, but they can really, really help. So I guess just take that advice with a grain of salt. They do have a point they're trying to make there, but it's not really a blankety solution or blanket. I wouldn't take that literally. I haven't read that book too, I must admit. I learned from a book many, many years ago called See for Yourself, and it no longer exists. It cannot be bought. I haven't seen that book in years. I can't even find it on the internet. But it was a simple book on the C-based language. Okay, cool. We got branches outlined, blocked in. That's looking good. So it's time to do the tree branches or the tree, the leaves. That's what they're called, leaves. You didn't know that was possible, right? Yeah, it is. It totally is. So, all you do is basically you write your code, whatever. Let's say, I'm using Vim or whatever to write my code. Something dot blah 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 blah. I'd write, I'm working on my CPP file. Oh, I'm writing my code. Blah 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 blah. Save your code. Exit, and then you just call if you're using GCC, you would call GCC const dot C to C or whatever, and that would compile it into an object file, and then you would link it and stuff with another command. It's really not that hard. Learn it a little bit for sure. You'll become a ninja, man. You become a game development ninja. You'll start to understand really what's going on with the compiler too, and what the IDE is doing. Like watch when Xcode compiles. Wait, let's change a little bit of code so it actually compiles something. Tile. There, it thinks to change that file, so it's going to compile. And let's watch what's going on here in the build. So the IDE basically, see this? It's compiling all these files, linking it, boom, done, registering it, copying files, done. But here's the two most important parts. Compile, that compiles a single file into an object file. Link takes all the object files and puts them together into an executable file. You need to understand this whole process and what it's doing for you. And if let's check this out. If I want to zoom in a little bit, where's one of these, like world.cpp? This is the actual command that Xcode used to build all this. I know this looks hugely intimidating, but your actual command line builds will not look anything like this. They'll maybe look like, a tiny bit. They'll be like, doo doo doo, compile this, compile that, use these options. Output to here. There's just a lot of stuff going on with all these warning switches and includes and stuff like that on for this because I'm using a huge game engine called CocoS2DX and it has 150,000 lines of code. So that's why that command line compile right there looks so intimidating. Okay, so I'm gonna start with this. Where we got? Oh, yeah, there, that, yeah. Okay, highlights time. Nice, yeah. So I'm just going and drawing in some highlights with this sort of lighter color first. And then I'm going to go in and do some softer highlights. Like they'll just be a little bit kind of a blend between this color and a color kind of close to it. And then I'll add some darker shadows. And then maybe a couple really bright highlights on the top of everything else. And anybody that just joined the stream, apologies, I can't really play music on this stream because I publish these all to YouTube, and then YouTube flags the videos like, oh my God, you're infringing copyright laws. You're putting music on your stream. But I do listen to music when I make games. In my private time, I listen to Rush a lot. I love Rush lately. Tool's one of my favorite bands. Of course, because I grew up in the 90s. Yeah, Rage Paint, they do. Not Twitch. Twitch has this stuff that like automatically silences your video or whatever if it detects any copyrighted material. YouTube just straight up flags the entire video. It's like, oh, nope, this whole video has some copyrighted content, and what it makes it so it cannot play the video in certain territories, certain countries. So it just, and it kind of is like a red flag on your account and stuff. What's up, PMC? Welcome, welcome, welcome. Welcome to today's stream. So I'm just kind of imagining in my mind, like where would the light? Okay, so the light always in this game is always coming from above, straight above, and coming straight down, kind of facing downwards a little bit. So that's why it makes it simple for making this game to always kind of have the light coming from one direction. And you'll know if you notice, a lot of games do that. A lot of games will actually have the light always coming from one direction. Just makes it kind of easy for the artists. And I don't consider myself an advanced artist or anything. I'm a brand new artist. So I've got to use techniques like that to just make things simpler. Alex Pita, what's up, buddy? Belazio. Yeah, right, Arcane, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, Pedro, it's totally true, right? They should do that. And I think Game Show, the software I'm using, I think they have plans to do that where you can have a different stuff that's recorded versus stuff that's streamed. I'm not sure though. Yeah. All okay, right on, Pita. So I'm working on the mother tree here right now, and then later I'm gonna work on some patterns. So I've been working on these patterns and stuff, and there's this one pattern I want to work on today where it's got a few dots. Where's one of these patterns? Know there's one of them around here somewhere. Like here's kind of one. Oh, here's one. So this is the one with dots. It just randomly puts a bunch of tiles everywhere. I want to work on this pattern so it just looks a little bit better. Yeah, I think you just have to have separate settings or whatever for what you're broadcasting versus what you're recording. Sergeant Sam, yes. Yeah, they haven't fully designed their NPCs yet, but everybody that's did that has are given me kind of a an outline of how they want their NPCs to work. I'm going to be getting into doing the NPCs a little bit later on. Right now I'm focusing on getting more of the basic mechanics of the game finished and stuff. So I kind of got to kind of keep those for later. And besides, the NPCs are going to have a lot to do with story, and I really want to do the story last so that I can kind of keep it a secret, you know what I mean? I don't want to ruin the story for everyone, especially with the live stream. So it kind of was is when I get to the end of this game, making this game, it's going to be kind of like spoiler alert season, you know? Like it's like watch the stream at your own risk because there's going to be a lot of, spoiler stuff going on. So I want to save that for last. I want to get to the beta done without even having really much of a story in it. So you can kind of play the whole game but not really experience the story until the very end, until the final release. Thanks, Scottish Pizza. Yeah, this is, I mean, it's just like Zelda. But with newer graphics and more modern stuff, and it's procedurally generated, so yep, this is it. It's called Songbringer. You can get tons of items, but I only have a couple of them right now because this is a new save. You got these. There's this one item called the Ghost Sword. I'll show that really quick. This is one of the funnest weapons in the game. The Ghost Sword. Let's get the Fire Sword. Jib's the main guy's father. Oh, I can't give away anything. I can't give away anything, but that's a really funny idea. This is the fire sword. I haven't got the diagonal movement of the sword done yet. In fact, the sword's weird. But yeah, this is a really fun sword. There's also the lightning sword. Me show that one. That one's cool. Cool, man. Yeah, the beta is going to be out in a few months. Will the full game be paid? Yes. Oh, yeah, of course the full game is going to be paid. Yeah, this is a 2-year project. This is taking 2 years of my life to create, man. This is a definitely a full-on complete game. It's not going to be a free game. No way in hell it'll be free. In fact, I learned my lesson the hard way about making free games with my last game. It just we spent 2 years of our lives making a free game, and then no one bought it. No one paid for any in-app purchases, and we lost a hell of a lot. It sucked. It's one of the worst experiences of my life. So no, I'm definitely not gonna make free games ever again. PMC. Yes, he is a dead, not necessarily a boy. He lived a whole life before he converted himself into a robot. But yeah, he could potentially have a lineage though. It's a dad boy. Mars of Power, what's up? Yes. Thanks, Scottish Pizza. I appreciate you saying that, man. Yes, it's just me making this. I make the art, I make the music and the code and everything else. So I really appreciate you saying that, man. It's good to hear that kind of feedback because it really just reminds me that, what I'm doing is special. This is a cool game, and there's a lot of fans out there already that are, playing this game, loving it, playing the alpha and all that, and also really looking forward to the beta and the new versions coming out and stuff. So it's good to remember that when you're a creator, sometimes it's easy to get down. Everybody's human, right? And I have my days just like anyone else. So it's really good to remember that there's a group of people that are really stoked already to play this game and that really respect where it's going and what it is, what kind of game it is and stuff like that. So Thanks, man. Thanks for helping me remember that. Nico, where, what?
Nico?
You can't see him because he's a ninja. Oh, what I said about free games, I'm just not gonna do them. I definitely prefer to make paid games. Okay, what's the protagonist's name? Rock, ROQ. Thanks, Marza. Nico. John Cena. That's not the main character. Marza, how you been, Marza? What you been doing, man? Yes, that's right. The real one's a ninja, and his name's Nico. Psh, don't tell anybody. All right. Looks like we got a few highlights started. Thinking some of these are a little bit too much, though. Work, work, work. Arcane, I love that. That's funny. Nico is taking all the attention. I know, game show, duh. Wait. Doesn't it? Can't you guys see those? You can't see Franker faces anymore? Hold on. I thought Franker faces was like in full effect. You heard that indie devs are publishing. What? What do you mean? Why doesn't it show Franker faces? It should. Do you have Franker faces? Oh yeah, the Franker faces is there. You just gotta have the Franker faces
15 minutes could save.
plugin. I don't have it on my iPad because I don't know if it works for the iPad. Does it? Does Franker faces work for the iPad? I would definitely install that if it did. Okay, time for the next layer. This is gonna be sort of a darker highlight. And once again, I'm just imagining where light would hit. That's kind of how I think about making art. It's like so much of making art is thinking about how to take a three-dimensional object or whatever and draw it in two dimensions. That's really all art is. It's taking the 3D and making it 2D. Or at least two-dimensional art is that way. Oh, in my stream? Oh, I see, Sergeant Sam. Yeah, I guess so. How would I get Game Show to put those on there? That would be sweet. Because it's using some kind of plugin. Yeah, maybe I can look into that. What's up, Salad Dongs? This is the first time you're watching the stream, but you follow the YouTube. Cool, man. Nice. Nice. Thanks, Salad Dongs. Appreciate that, man. So PMC, you're saying that some games use a pu so indie games that use publishers are not really truly indie in your mind? Is that what you're saying? So I'm adding in more of this like darker highlight here. This is a beautiful highlight color because I don't know what it is, but it just really brings out the rest of the tree so well. Just a slightly darker color than this other one here. Ha! A wind statue made with a marshmallow? Cool. But what do you, so you're not saying that? Whoa, what were you saying? But what is indie? What is indie? That's a really good question. What constitutes an indie developer, right? What classifies a developer as being indie? It's a very good question, because that line is being blurred right now, you know? The team that made Ori and the Blind Forest, they won Indie of the Year, I think, at the Game Awards. And they're a big team, aren't they? How big is the team that made Ori and the Blind Forest? Pedro would know. This is a really great question. How do we determine indies, you know? And also, there's a new thing called Triple I, which is like the Triple A of indies. So do we, you know, are we going to use this term, the Triple I term, or is that stupid or what? Yes. Oh my God, I love this color. This really helps shape the tree. Yeah, see, I would say that most of the indie developers that you know, most of them are using publishers in some way. The relationship to publishers has changed a lot lately in the indie scene. There's publishers have actually gotten a lot cooler. They've gotten a lot more friendly. They've gotten more hip to an indie's needs, because indie developers are some of the making some of the coolest games out there right now, and they're making things that triple A's can't. You know, because triple A's have to make super awesome, totally 3D games, and their quality standard is huge. So they can't take risks. Indies can take risks. Yeah, they won a bunch of awards, didn't they? Oh, salad dongs, great definition. You see, indie has a spectrum rather than having a single definition. That's cool. I like that. You should that's quotable right there. You should quote salad dongs right there on that one. I wish Rocket Bunny were here, because he's got a quote book he's making about this. It's kind of like with music. There's indie labels, which at this point are almost as big as the traditional music labels. Yeah. Oh, Pedro. So Moon Studios have made Ori and the Blind Forest. They have 20 people, but they worked in the game with Microsoft Game Studios, which included like 50 people. So, right? So, yeah. So is that on the spectrum of indie or not? Probably, I guess. I don't know. Yeah, thanks, PFC. Thank you. I won't click on it right now, but I'll save it for later. Oh, and they're all ex-AAA developers. That explains why they're so their art is so amazing, and their game is just amazingly great quality and all that. Yeah, best art direction. That's the one I was thinking about. Art direction. That's the one I saw. And they got nominated for best action adventure too, right? Or something. So I'm just laying on the light here. Think about how the photons are gonna hit this tree. and then just drawing that. Right, Arcane, it's a good question. What is indie when it's used as a genre? It's like music too. It's another thing with music is like, you know, there's the indie genre of music, which, you know, same kind of thing with games now. They're using it as a genre. But what does that mean? Really nothing almost. And except that maybe it's the game is something that's more, I don't know, like less triple A. I don't know. It's, whoops. Thanks, Scottish Pizza. Nice, dude. Oh, that's awesome. Yeah, I'm glad. Yeah, I mean, this is the kind of game I've always wanted to make, is a procedurally generated Zelda game. And, man, it's a real pleasure to make this game, and I really hope it is an incredible pleasure to play this game, too. And I'll keep on working on this game until it is. Got a lot of ideas to make this game better, and, as game development goes, it just takes forever even to do just one idea. So it's just taking a long time to get the game to where the visions are, you know? Yeah, I believe indie is it a genre or a tag? I don't know. It's a good question. Yeah, right. That was a big question, right? The whole Rocket League. Right, yeah, Call of Duty, Destiny, AAA. I mean, don't get me wrong, I think AAA games are great. I don't know, I love indie games. I love simpler games. I love 2D. I love 2D gameplay. I love pixel art. I love the quirkiness and the risks that game developers take in indie games. You know, for some people that's their thing. Some people it's not their thing. Some people love AAA, and they think that indie sucks. You know, and that's their opinion. The current definition for indie is not having $1 million to spend on a game. That could be the criteria. Yeah, you like both indie and AAA, but just not mobile. I hear you on that one. Yeah, I heard a lot of mixed reviews about Fallout 4. Some people were really, you know, said there's bugs and stuff, and some people think it's like they're one of their favorite games. So I don't know what to think. It's not really my style of game. I don't really play AAA 3D games that much. I really prefer my 2D retro stuff. I'd rather play an old school 8-bit game, basically. Watching your dog levitate and block the door is priceless. Oh, so that was one of the bugs in Fallout 4? Your dog starts to levitate, like on accident, like it's a bug, and it blocks you from getting out a door? Yeah, graphics is really, really important to the AAAs, huh? Scottish Pizza, what did I spend the funds on the Kickstarter on? Gosh, this question is, I'm going to answer your question here. But hopefully, this insight gives you kind of some of the reality of what development is like, you know, for some people. For me, I'm totally broke. I have $20,000 of credit card debt, and I have no other source of income. So I had to spend all of the Kickstarter funds just on development. So I need about $1,500 a month just to live, right? That's to pay my rent, pay my bills, pay for food to eat. That's it. That's a very, very inexpensive lifestyle, $1,500. But so I had to spend every single dime of the Kickstarter on that, just on the rent and stuff like that. Just, this is development costs, you know, this is what it costs to develop, is just my time. My time costs $1,500 a month. So that's what I had to spend my money on. And there's no other way I could have spent funds on fun stuff, because there was nothing left. And in fact, the Kickstarter funds are running out in about 10 or 15 days. I'll have burned through all the 15 grand. Actually, it didn't turn out to be 15 grand. It was more like 11 grand. In the end. And if you read the Gama Sutra article, I explain in detail how all that breaks down. But yeah, so there you go. I spent all the money on just development costs, which are my rent and my food, basically. But I hope that kind of gives you some insight into what other developers are experiencing as well. Other indies have kind of similar situations, you know? Maybe some of them. Really? Pedro, beer. No. Oh, man. If I had enough money to actually spend money on beer, that would be awesome. One of these days, I really do hope to be a wealthier game developer. I know that's a difficult thing to achieve in today's sort of game development environment. You know, it's not easy to be a wealthy and successful game developer, but hopefully one of these days I will be. That would be really cool. I would love to have the peace of mind just to know that, you know, everything's okay, that I have enough money to make through next month. You know, this would be really cool to experience that. PETA, will this be like a monster? No, I'm not thinking it's going to be a monster, but that's the second time somebody's asked this. So maybe this should be a monster at some point. I think it will be some kind of secret. Oh, thanks, Scottish Pizza. I hope it does. This is paradise. You should do a drunk live stream one day. I've done two so far in this game so far. One of them was the Kickstarter success day. I drank some beer some whiskey or something. I forget what I was drinking, but that was fun. Yeah, I'll do some more drunk streams. High streams would be fun too. I know I don't have money to spend on alcohol, but we have a lot of beer in our fridge right now from this one party we had. It was my fiance's birthday, and we still have beer left over from it. So we got beer, dude. I don't even have to spend money on it. And drunk and 24 hours. Sorry to say, which one do you think is better, starting on a game development alone or starting with a small group of people? Well, you know, you're asking the kind of person that's going to tell you pretty, in my mind, one is, of course, the better way to do it. The more you can learn, the more self-reliant you can be in game development, I think the better. Because what sucks is sometimes you can get into a team, right, and then one of your team members leaves. Or maybe you have problems with one of your team members. It's like a band, you know what I mean? Like a freaking band from the 70s or something like that, where there's all this drama and stuff. I just think it's easier to avoid drama and all the other potential issues that you can have in teams and learn stuff on your own. That way you get to make the game however the hell you want anyways. You don't have to cow or not cow, what's the word? You don't have to like compromise. You don't have to make choices that water down the vision maybe that you have for a game or whatever. So I just think it's way, way better to make your own stuff. And besides, you learn more that way. Pedro brings up a great point here, though. The only really correct option is to finish a game. I highly agree with that. There's so many people that don't finish games. And that's why I recommended those extra credits videos earlier, because one of the first things those extra credit videos will teach you is how to scope small. And what that means is you take what you want to make, and then make that vision as small as you possibly can. So scope your game all the way down to the simplest, shortest, quickest game you could possibly make. And that's what you should make first. Because you can, and you'll get it done, and then you'll be proud, and you'll build up a feeling of success, you know. Okay, we're looking at one last color to add to this. Yeah, total sketch. A paradise I'm standing. Yeah, I stand up and code and draw on everything. I sit down for about half the day. I stand up for about half the day. You're in a band, but they're not gonna get close to your game. Cool, man. Yeah. And then again, there are certain situations where a team is the dopest thing ever. You know, if you have some kind of dream team where you have some like great friends or did you just somehow you have the greatest situation ever, then hell yes, a team is a great thing. But I would say, you know, in general, that's a difficult thing to find. It isn't too boring? Too boring, what do you mean? Standing up? Hell no. Standing up gives me energy, man. Makes my spine straight. It's definitely not boring. And it's not tiring anymore. It used to be tiring when I first started, but now it's really easy to stand up and it gives me more energy. Like I feel better from standing. You need to make another five bird, then you can buy a mansion. Wizard Fu, Xbox One or PS4? What you mean, like, what's my preference? What do I prefer to play on? I would definitely prefer to play on PlayStation 4 myself. If you're talking about what I would prefer to put this game on, also PlayStation 4, because they're just way better developers. At least on the current release. Hopefully Microsoft gets better about their indie support in the next Xbox. Hopefully Nintendo gets a better system for this next one too, because they've also been not as awesome for indies. They've never really been awesome for indies, but hopefully they get better. Yeah. Oh man, it's so great to see just these tiny little highlights. They add so much. There's a couple of parts here that are too dark though. This is too dark here. And this little crack right here is a little bit too dark. All right, nice. Got this tree looking good. I'm gonna go ahead and check this in. Where did I save this? Oh, it might be in common mother tree. Oh, there it is, mother tree. There we go. So that's checked in. Yeah, Scottish Pizza, I agree. Right. The old Xbox was way better. The Xbox Live Arcade was an awesome system. And then they just messed it up. I really think they should bring back the Xbox Live Arcade. Thanks, Sergeant Sam. Yeah. Yep, yep. I agree with PMC there. They kind of ruined it there for a second. All right, so the next thing to add on here is these leaves. Paradise, yeah. Will I switch to coding? Yes, I'm going to switch to coding and finish up these patterns. I was developing some patterns which kind of are sprinkled around the overworld. All right, good night, Sergeant Sam. See you, man. I know, yeah, Arcane, right? Pixel art takes a while, right? It does take a while. Oh, no, I see what you're saying, right? I just added all this art for detailing out this tree, and then now I'm covering it all with leaves. But, okay, let me justify this. I'm actually going to have two different versions of this tree in the game. So one version is going to be the tree without leaves, and then another version is the tree with the leaves. So that's why I did all that in detail back there, and I'm going to do some detail on the leaves. So... right. Let's do some. Start with these. Oh, right. Yeah, I know. It's funny, right? Yeah, Bob Ross. Sega made a hockey game? On PC? What? Wait, what's Sega been doing lately? So they did the Dreamcast back in the day. Are they just out of the console business now, or what? Now they're happy trees, right? Sega should make a Sonic game. They're making mobile games and PC games? All right, Seb, good night, man. Yeah. Good luck with C, man, and C++. Nice nuclear. Yeah, dude, cool. It's pixel art's fun, dude. I love pixel art. Actually, it's a really nice thing to code for a little while each day and also make pixel art because it gets your brain in a different zone, you know? They're kind of different. They're very complementary tasks. You know, I can code all day and then get stuck on something and be totally frustrated with code and then go and do pixel art and be just like vindicated. Like, you know, it's just so easy to make pixel art compared to code. And sometimes it's the other way around. Sometimes code saves me. You know, sometimes I'm like trying to make pixel art all day and I'm like, damn, I'm stuck. I don't know what to do with this pixel art at this point. And I go and code and it feels great. And I'm like, yes, I might be a new pixel art artist, but at least I'm a accomplished coder. At least I can do this. So that they're really great complementary, you know, activities and stuff. Oh, you're a dudette? Oh. Nice. What's up, dudette? Standing desks are for hipsters. This is not a standing desk. This is just a closet, man. I'm literally inside a closet. I'm coding inside a closet. I'm making pixel art in a closet. Do I use smart pointers? No, I don't. Everybody tells me I need to start using them, but I haven't yet. Wait, what? I appear in the streamers list? What are you saying there, Pedro? About a streamers list? Insert closet joke, yes. Lambdas all the time, dude. I use lambdas almost all the time. Everywhere. Whoops. You know, I use lambdas like one example of using lambdas lately. Where is that? I did that. Oh, collision system. So here's an example of this cool thing I did to check this out. This is a static map that I initialize with. What the key for the map is an integer value, an enum that this is like a certain collision type, and then the actual data or the value of the map is a lambda function. So this is a lambda function that can run off of, you know, simply just doing that. And then to call it, all you got to do is look through the flags for something and then run the appropriate function. I love lambda functions. They have really, really made developing C++ so much easier. But you know what's funny is we've always had the ability to do lambda functions. Lambdas are just essentially functors, and functors have been around since we've had structs. So the entire time, we've always had the ability to use lambdas. It's just that lambdas make it syntactically easier, faster, and quicker to make these kind of functions. PMC, no, this is a tablet and a pen stylus. Wait, theme voting starting soon? Oh, Wizard Foo? Oh, hey, it lists me as I'm as a live streamer right now. Oh, because because I'm live on game in the game dev category right now. Probably. Scottish, did I study programming? Yes. No, please. Yeah, ask questions all you want. You're new to development and new to streams. Oh, okay. That's fine. Yeah, dude, ask all the questions you want, and yes, I've studied game development or programming informally. I studied it by reading books as a kid. And yeah, that's all I did. I read books as a kid and I learned to program games, and I actually programmed my first game when I was 14 years old. I started making my first game. This is back in the DOS days. These are totally different than days than today. But yeah, I studied just basically informally. I never went to college for game development, but I did study programming at college for a couple years. But I dropped out because I already was making games and I really wasn't learning much at school. And there were no girls at my school, dude. No dudettes. I was very, very, I found it very unsatisfactory to have no dudettes at my school. So I left school. I never graduated and probably never will. I did graduate high school. And that's enough for me. Yeah. You hope I remember you when I'm drinking mojitos in my mansion? Yeah. First of all, it would be scotch. Second of all, I don't think I'll ever have a mansion. Even if I was a billionaire, I don't really like mansions. I would definitely develop a really cool custom home at some point, but not a mansion. Is funny stuff to talk about. Okay. I'm gonna take a step back here and look at this overall. Yeah, this is overall starting to look better with some highlights and stuff on this. So I want to kind of shape these bushes a little bit more. Drunk chimpanzee, what's up, man? Scotch and gummy bears. That's all you need. That's all you need. Some gummy bears and scotch. Scotch, scotch, scotch. I love scotch. Yeah, so anybody that's just joined the stream, let me play the game really quick so you're like, what is this? This is this game. It's called Songbringer. And I'm drawing a big tree that it's going to be placed. This is a procedurally generated Zelda-like game. So the game actually generates, the entire game is generated. There's nothing ever stored to disk. The entire game is also generated based on six letters. So you give it six letters when you start a game. And all of those six letters create your entire world. So I'm playing a world called Wizard right now, and that world Wizard has a certain shape and everything, and then it also has, every single tile on every area is procedurally generated. So this is it. It's called Songbringer. And yeah, I'm working on patterns and stuff like that. I'm working on adding more interesting stuff to the open world. So that's why I'm working on this big tree right now. So this big tree will be something you find somewhere in the overworld, and they'll just be a big tree on the screen. And that's it. It's probably gonna take me all day just to draw this tree and put it in, but oh well. It'll be cool. It'd be cool to have a big tree. Oh, did it say thanks? I hate video games. Yeah, I think that guy is in there. There's a couple in there that are NA, and I need to get rid of those because I'm pretty sure NA means they didn't even want their name in there. Yeah. See you. Okay. All right. See you tomorrow, Pedro. Have fun with Rocket League. Yeah, nuclear. There's definitely gonna be NPCs. There's caves, just like the original Zelda. But yeah, there are orbs already. There's these like floating orbs, which which are eventually going to be some kind of secret. I'm not sure. But let me go into God mode, or yeah, God mode, invincibility, so I can run around and show you there's some... Where's the orbs at? There's an orb. There's gonna, like I said, there's gonna be some kind of secret attached to this. I'm not sure what it's gonna be yet. Yeah, so. There's something else. Some other kind of orb somewhere. I don't know. Total Biscuit? Cool. Yeah, I would love to have some big streamers cover it. That'd be cool. Do I plan to extend to multiplayer in the future? Paradise, that's a great question. Yes and no. Local multiplayer, yes. Real-time multiplayer, as in like network multiplayer, no. And I, you know, I know how awesome multiplayer is, and I've developed a multiplayer game before. My last video game was a multiplayer game. It's called Hero Bash. It's a multiplayer MOBA for iOS. And let me just tell you, it is hella hard to make real-time multiplayer games. It takes so much time. So I'd rather make this game an awesome single-player game than to spend all that time making it also a multiplayer game. So yes, I'm going to add local multiplayer where you can play with a friend in the same room as them. But no, I'm never going to add real-time multiplayer to this game. Maybe Songbringer 2 in the future. I would add real-time multiplayer, or like Songbringer 3 or something like that, sure. But for this one, no, I'm going to have to keep it simple. Oh no, Total Biscuit. Oh wow. Gosh, that's crazy. Who's that guy, Gary? Who's the guy that won the best YouTuber Game Awards guy? What was that guy? Gary something? Yeah. Yeah. Stealthy Ninja Slice, this game is coming out next year, 2016. Where can you get it? Steam. Just look for Songbringer on Steam or click on any of the links there. You can click on the info for the chat. There's plenty of links to all of it. There's a link to the Steam page and everything. And you can wishlist it on Steam and then pay attention to when it's released. And there you go, dude. Yep, so it's, you know, this is a year into developing this game so far. And there's still, you know, at least 3 to 6 months left. It's taking longer than expected, but I'd rather make a quality game than make a game and then to release it quickly, you know. And I don't want to do early access. I think that early access is kind of, you know, misleading to players. You don't know when to buy it. It's like, oh, should I buy this game or not? Oh, should I just wait till it comes out, you know? Will there be DLC? No, I do not plan to add any DLC because I just, I don't want to require more money from people. What I'm going to do is add free updates. So I don't want to add DLC, but I guess it kind of is DLC in the sense that you can just upgrade your game and get free updates, you know, get the free updates, have more stuff. I kind of think that once you buy a game, it's like, why would you go and why do I have to pay more? But I guess I see the point that, yeah, some DLCs are really cool, you know. So I don't know. I guess I'm going to stay open-minded to that. Maybe one day I'll change my mind and be like, all right, I guess I should have some DLC content here that is actually paid or whatever. But I don't know. I'm kind of thinking that should be Songbringer 2. You know, if I'm ever making something that's worthy of a DLC, then it should probably just be the next version. It's a movie, Rebirth, Afterbirth 2. Greg Miller, that's his name, yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Will implement mods? Yes, mods are already a go, already confirmed. Yes, there's going to be mods, and they're going to be super easy too. Check this out. All the data for the game is all in these text files, and you can change almost everything. You know, if you wanted to make the bombable pillars have a different image, all you have to do is add this image to the data for the game's data folder, and then, you know, change whatever you want about it. So yeah, you can change everything from textures of the ground to everything. Even check this out, you can change the enemies. Let's say I wanted to change the Roz enemy and I want to make him so he has less hit points. I would just go edit the text file. It's really easy to mod this game. But the one thing is that the game's going to auto-detect if it's been modded. It's going to basically do a checksum on all the data. And if it detects that it's been modded, then it's not going to upload your scores or anything to the leaderboards. So that's the one caveat. What's up, Arcor? Oh yeah, episodes might be cool too, but I think what I want to do is do the entire story at once. You know, I want people to have the entire experience of this game from day one. You know, so that's why I want to release this game well done from the start. Oh, so Greg Miller's not a great YouTuber? Why did he get the award then? On the Game Awards. Alright, so we're getting close to being somewhat done with this tree. So I can put it in the game, see what it looks like. Things always change when you put them in the game. You know, you draw something once in Photoshop, but then when in the game, it takes on the lighting of the game and, you know, so it's always good to see things in the game rather than just in Photoshop. Thanks for the follow. Do I think I'll ever work on a 3D game? Yeah, I probably will at some point. I already have, but in the future, yeah, I might do a 3D game, maybe. Yeah, like at this point in my life, I love 8-bit games and everything, but there may be a day where I'm like, you know what, I'm ready to do some 3D games. So I'm definitely not gonna strike that off the list or anything. I think if I did make 3D games, I would probably make them with a fixed perspective, you know, where you're looking, the camera's always looking one way. I like those kind of 3D games. Arcor, I'm great, dude. The game's going great. Yep, stuff in the game, and I'm working on adding more patterns. And I will code a little bit today after I finish this tree. Here's one of the new overworld patterns. This is just a pattern where if the interior of an area is completely open, it can add a pattern. And here's one of the patterns that's just basically with a tree in the middle. So there's lots of other patterns I'm working on too, like rows of stuff. And here's an area, for example, that would really benefit from having a pattern. So like this is just screaming, hey, I need a pattern right here. Oh, the award wasn't aimed for the best YouTuber? Yeah. You've been playing with Go? Cool. Nice. Whoa, dude. Greg Miller has nowhere near the subscribership as PewDiePie. Oh, Salad Dongs. I'm so looking forward to Jai as well. If Jai was out right now, I would be hard for me not to go and reprogram my entire game. All 40,000 lines of it. Yeah, I can't wait for Jai. What, have you heard anything about Jai lately? Celadons, when is he going to release the compiler? Seriously. When is he gonna really, or release his translator or whatever for that? Because I'm like dying to use a better programming language. And Jai is awesome. I've seen everything. I've looked at everything about it. How will I check if the game's modded? Yeah, there'll be a checksum. So like when I release the game in its final version, I'll do a checksum on all the data, all these text files for the game. These are just the enemies so far. There's a lot of other text files, you know. All these text files and all the graphics and everything will all be checksummed, and then so the game can, when it, the game starts up, it does the checksum again and checks all its data basically to see if it's been modified or not. And that so if the game has been modified, it will run in a sort of an altered state where it's aware of that modification. Are there any boss fights? Yeah, there already are boss fights. There's levels. Check it out, man. There's already levels and bosses and everything. Let me warp to a level and I'll show you. My game's looking like Binding of Isaac. The big difference between Binding of Isaac and this game is, first of all, this game has an overworld. But second of all, Binding of Isaac uses preset patterns. So every one of the screens in Binding of Isaac is something that Edmund McMillan pre-created. He prefabricated all these rooms, and then all Binding of Isaac does is it randomly arranges those rooms. Songbringer is a lot different. It actually goes down to the tile level and actually generates every single screen with an algorithm. So yes, some of those algorithms are patterns, which essentially is kind of like Binding of Isaac in a way that of using like prefabricated stuff. But other stuff is using algorithms to merge with other areas and stuff. So it really blends things and creates areas that cannot be created with just prefabrication. So this has a bug here. It's Plasma Bolt missing an input component. Input. Allow 4. Yeah, I know, running code at compile time. Yeah, dude, so many things about Jai make it so rad. All right, see you, PMC. Thanks, Arcore, yeah. Bye, dude, have a good one. Oh, another bug with these guys. Small explosion, also missing input component. I just added all this new code that checks more strictly how entities are being created and stuff. So that's why I'm getting a few bugs here. So I just want to clear them out before I something else. And what I did there just to kill all those enemies, I have a couple debug buttons. You know, I've got a lot of different debug things I can turn on to sort of debug stuff, and I can slow down time, speed up time. Here's like really, really slow time. Here's like extra fast time. And also I can turn on God mode, invincibility, kill all the enemies on the screen, or kill myself. So that really, really helps with debugging. Okay, back to this tree. Almost finished with this tree. Almost ready to put it in. There's something wrong with this tree. This is lacking depth. I need a darker color, but that's not quite this dark. In fact, I think I'm going to go and take that color and put it at like 20% opacity or something. No, maybe more like 50. Yeah, there we go. 50% opacity. Good. And now that I've got this color kind of... Oops. Let's make it a little bit deeper in its hue. And now I can go back to 100% opacity and draw straight up on top of it. Yeah. Is there a tutorial? No, there's no tutorial for this game. I know a lot of games today do that, but this is not really one of those kind of games. There will probably need to be a little bit of messaging that will say, you know, like say, okay, use the A button to use the sword or whatever. But really, I'm not really a fan of games that have to hold your hand so much. And this game is supposed to be inspired by 8-bit games, where 8-bit games didn't hold your hand at all. And so, you know, yes, there kind of has to be a balance between the 8-bit not holding your hand at all and the today's holding your hand excessively. I'm sure there's got to be some kind of balance there. But in general, I'm going to lean towards the side of the table where it's, you know, where it's not even holding your hand at all. So, yeah. Happy today, everybody. Hope you're having a good Sunday. I'm just making some pixel art for the game today. I guess I'm probably not going to code that much because I probably spent the whole day drawing this pixel art. Yeah, I have. Only got 10 more minutes. Well, okay, I guess it's not going to be a code day. But today was an art day. I like art days. They're really simple. Easy on the brain. Really nice. Are there Easter eggs? Yes, there are, my friend. Yes, there are. Some of them have not been created yet. I want to have a lot more Easter eggs. Easter eggs are freaking awesome. But lots of secrets, too. Easter eggs, secrets, different things. But the secrets, too, are just off the hook, man. I want those to be amazing. Just like Zelda 1. Zelda 1 had just rad secrets everywhere. On the whole overworld, there was like secret here, secret there, secret there. I want this game to be like that. So you're constantly rewarded for exploring and trying stuff. And then some of those rewards are going to be Easter eggs. It's like, oh, well, I just found this bomb. I can find, there's a secret area. And oh, there's an Easter egg. What is this? Yeah, there is one. Yep, there's definitely a waterfall secret. There's lots of bombable secrets so far. You can like place a bomb here and boom, blow up a wall. Oh, another thing about secrets is when you have cactuses, you can eat your cactuses and they give you psychedelic powers where you can see secrets. So you can see places where you would bomb and stuff. So it's kind of a cool tool that you can identify those areas. But some of them are still, even though you might have a cactus, some secrets are not even going to be identifiable with the cactus. So that'll be fun too, and even more rewarding if you find those secrets. Secrets of the cacti. Cactus, cacti, bambus, bambi. Bambi? Colleen, what's up? What's up? Yeah, English is weird. Who invented this language? Okay, I don't know what to do about this tree. It's not looking as cool as I. Oh, maybe some more highlights will help. It's the Normans. It's all their fault. Nice, Scottish pizza. Thanks, man. No, I really, really appreciate you saying that. Yeah, dude, I'm really glad because that's why I started streaming. I wanted to share the process of game development and share it for posterity too. You know, by putting it on YouTube, people in the future can kind of see how a game is made and how one person can do it. You know, I wanted to really show people that one person can totally make a game. And I mean, there's already been other examples, like for example, Axiom Verge, amazing game, one guy. He made all the art, all the music, everything. And I really want these live streams to be inspirational. So I'm glad they're inspiring you, and I really hope they inspire other people too. And I'm really glad you said that because it's good for you to share it because, you know, sometimes when I'm streaming, sometimes it's hard, dude. It's hard to stream. It's hard to talk and code. It's hard to do these every day. Some days I'm like, dude, I don't even want to stream today. You know, it just sounds like too much work. But so it's good for you to say that and remind me that this is really inspiring people out there and that it's a good thing. So cheers, man. Appreciate you saying that. Toby Fox made Undertale alone as well? I didn't know that. Undertale's on my list of games to get. I think I should get it sooner than later. So what do you guys think? What should I price this game as on Steam when it finally comes out? Should it be 15 bucks or 10?
How much time are you gonna be?
Only about 10 minutes.
Okay, I'm gonna start dinner.
All right. This is cool to see Undertale get nominated for stuff at the Game Awards, and also it was sweet to see Axiom Verge get nominated as well. Yeah, I gotta get this game. Was it really cool? Have you guys played this? We gotta vote for 15. 15, 15, 15. Oh, cool. 15. All right. Nice, cool. So he did a lot of the art. That's awesome. Yeah, so this is my kind of game. I'm definitely going to own this game at some point. Looks awesome. Yeah, nice. Cool. All right, what's up, J2? Yeah, cool. I will. Yeah, I'll definitely play that. Nice. Cool. So yeah, it's great to get your guys' feedback on the price too. Like, 'cause I'm considering 10 bucks, but I was actually considering 20 bucks for a while. I was like, oh, I should make it 20 'cause Axiom Verge is 20. But then again, I took a look at, you know, Axiom Verge's sales and they're not as high as I would have imagined they would have been. So, you know, we were talking about that on the stream one day. We're like, you know what? 20 bucks is kind of too much for an indie game, you know, for a retro indie game especially. So I think 20 is too expensive. 15 is kind of the sweet spot, it sounds like. So thanks again for sharing you guys' opinions on that too. Yeah, Rage Paint, good point, good point. Good point on that. That yeah, backers paid 16 bucks for this game. So for it to go down would kind of suck for them. Hey, good night, Paradise. Yeah, salad dongs, right? Yeah. I probably would too, but I'm a real, real hardcore lover of retro games, so that's why I paid $20 for Axiom Verge. But I gotta be honest, I held off for a long time before buying Axiom Verge because it was $20. You know, I probably would have bought it way sooner if it were 15. And it's weird, $15 and 20 is not that much of a difference. It's just a psychology thing, I guess. Yeah. Nice. Scottish pizza, you are from Scotland. Thanks, Sandesco. Yeah. Oh, hey, thanks, TM. What's up, TM? How you doing today? Yeah, Zandesco, that's a huge thing. That's a huge distinction to make is how much real work there is and then how much perceived work there is. Yeah. Thank you, man. Thank you. Yeah, perceived value versus actual value. That's a whole discussion right there. And I learned that kind of the hard way recently with the Indy Cup. The Indy Cup, I'm going to this thing in San Francisco next week, and Songbringer's going to be there. And but that means that I'm going to be there. And yeah, you can play Songbringer in person at this Indy Cup thing, and there's a $10,000 prize, right? So there's four different, or there's eight different games that have been chosen already as or seven different games that are chosen as finalists in this category and everything like that. And basically the judges for this Indy Cup picked the games, the finalists, based on the presentation, your marketing presentation. So they did not even play the games. It's just the presentation. And so that's where perceived value versus actual value comes into play. And also when you're selling your game, you know, perceived value and actual value are come into play huge there too. So your game might actually be really cool, but if it's not perceived that it's cool, then you're going to be missing out on sales and or whatever kind of attention you're trying to get or whatever. So that's really important, is to try and convey the awesomeness of your game somehow. You know, you gotta, that's another thing to master as far as marketing and indies go. Yeah, totally. The one without the leaves is looking pretty good because it's already done, but the leaves will get there too, you know. Yeah, right. Him Savage, yeah, I agree with you there, right? The actual economics of selling your game at a lower price, you get more overall players that way, you know? I guess it's kind of a quality versus quantity thing. So yeah, I think adding a little more shadows to the bottom of this tree, and then also adding the cast shadow to the bottom will really, really help this tree leaves pop. And then once it's in the game, the actual game's lighting will take effect, and I think it'll look better that way. So, yeah, I'm getting close to the end of my stream today. I stream for about 2 hours a day, usually at least 5 days a week. And I'm always streaming at about this time, too. So if anybody's, you're just new to the stream or whatever, you're like, all right, what's this guy about? I stream daily. My name's Nathaniel. I'm making this game called Songbringer. I've been making it for about a year. And, yeah, I stream every day. So you can always catch me streaming my game pretty much every day around this time. And Yeah, so I'm not done with the stream yet, but I will be here in about 10 minutes or so. Yeah, hopefully, yeah. Yep. You guys will be like, "Wow, I saw that guy actually making that game." Okay. This is getting to the point where I need to throw this in the game and see how it's looking, but I do want to do a couple more little touches. But I will throw this in the game before I close down today's stream. In fact, I need to get a mother tree tile compiled in here, so I'm gonna add a tile right now. So I need a tile type. Here's tree. Let's see a mother tree. It's not really a mother tree. It's more like an interest tree, I guess. I'm going to call this tree interest. And then area, I need a function to be able to create one of these kind of trees. Nice, right on. Cool. Yeah, I'm here. Any day you want to check out game dev, learn stuff, be inspired, just hang out. Sometimes we chat about the randomest stuff on this stream, but usually related to game development and or the indie scene somehow. Okay, one more thing. I want to take this shadow. So I'm going to duplicate that layer. Make this completely black. Put it below the tree here. And squish it. Nice. Yeah, it inspires you. Cool. Right. Yeah, being too much of a perfectionist, that's, oh, I can relate there, man. I could totally relate. Yeah, and that's why I recommend those extra credit videos because they help you to realize, how to scope small and how to, I guess how to be sort of happy with scoping small. That's important too, right? You got to be happy with what you do. Okay, so let's turn off the palette, turn off this other tree, turn off the background. I'm gonna export this whole thing as one big layer first. Okay, let's see what this looks like in the game with the game's lighting and stuff. Yeah, of course, Total Sketch. Yeah, please post your progress. I'd love to see. Okay, another thing, this needs to be trimmed. Sweet. It's still loading for me, but yeah. Oh, nice, dude. That's rad. It's cool wolf. Yeah, dude, I like your prog. Dude, this is looking awesome. Good job. I love your background trees. I love the twilight sort of sunset thing in the background, the awesome big moon, the shape of your trees, the sketching on your wolf. Everything looks great, dude. Good job. Nice, man. Nice, right on. Yeah, the shadows probably should have the leaves. I'm just exporting it all like this right now just to try it real quick. So I'll actually export this as two different things. There'll be, you know, the bottom and then the top, and then they'll both have different shadows and stuff like that. Yeah, dude, good job. Okay, so I've got that set up. Let's get this code going so we can have a tree in there. First thing, I need to hook up the area CPP method to create this kind of tile. So if we create a K tile tree in interest, tree interest tile. And now an area creation, I can create a gargoyle tile is kind of a good example of something that's really similar. It's easy. Here we go, gargoyle tile. So create tree interest tile. Yeah, isn't it? It is kind of like pointillism. Yeah. Pixel art's beautiful. I think it's a really, really beautiful thing. And what I love about pixel art is that it says game. You know, when I see pixel art, I'm like, oh, game. And that's pretty great to be able to get into a person's mind that quickly and convey the message of what you're creating that quickly. Like, oh, this is a game. It's a great thing to be able to convey, you know? Okay, so we're gonna start with the type 0, that's fine. I think I called this mother tree. And this is Z1, get color mix. No, we're not gonna mix the color. I don't need a color. I don't need an R. Keep it at that position. The thing about this is it does, I'll keep one collision component for now, but it's not going to need a shadow component. You know, that should be enough to create this. Yeah, how much meaning a single pixel can have. Yeah, it is cool. No, J2, I don't want to use the %OD format here. I would do that if that were what I wanted here, but that's not what I want here. But this first zero is the type of tree. The second zero is whether it has leaves or not. So that'll be something else. What's up, Pete and Wally? Yeah, totally. Okay, so there's something else. An area of patterns. I've got this thing where I can put down... what are they called? K flag interest is what I'm looking for. Pattern connector. Yeah, this is what we would interest if interest style switch R. Here we go. This is where I create interesting stuff. So let's run around the overworld until I find any one of these interest points, and then I'll quickly modify it. Oh, we want to be in the overworld, so back here, zero. Okay, so now I'm gonna run around the overworld and look for a point that has an interesting thing. And, there's one right here. Okay. There, I'm going to change this big sphere to a big tree. Okay, so the big sphere is, I think, that one. Yeah, so let's do W2, H2, tile, tree interest, no humming. Okay, so it definitely needs to come down a bit. Let's move it down like a lot more, maybe 7. I think it was too light in general. The color was all a little bit too light. It needs to kind of darken it up a bit. And I would also need to do the collision tiles right. Okay, so 7 was a bit too much here. And then, yeah, so this tree is going to need some special collision boxes. It's going to, the actual main entity is just going to be the render component, the graphics. And then I'm going to need to do special little individual collision components. Like, see, here's the collision components. They're in red. So right now it's putting a collision component for this tree right there only. But it'll need to put a collision component here, one square here, and then one square maybe here, and then maybe one over here to kind of complete this whole collision for this. But other than that, I guess it's looking okay. Yeah, I guess it does look okay. I don't know if I would really change that much. Maybe the shadow could be better. What games inspired me to create Songbreaker besides Zelda? Yeah, besides the very first Zelda, that's my main inspiration, but Solstice for the NES, that's a big inspiration. Final Fantasy, even the first Final Fantasy is a huge inspiration. Chrono Trigger and all the 16-bit Zelda, you know, Zelda 3. Live asset reloading? No. I would do that, but it's not really, it could be useful. It would definitely would be useful, Salad Dongs, but it would almost take so much time to do that it wouldn't really be that, I guess I wouldn't really need it. Is it a scissor tree? What's that? Yeah, the debug modes are super handy. Super duper. J2, no, I'm not actually going to do that. So yeah, the area behind the tree, you're just not going to be able to see yourself. So this might be better suited for an area that has this like blocked off on top. But no, I don't have any plans for you being able to see yourself behind stuff in this game. I kind of like the fact, this is kind of an aesthetic thing, you know? You know, some games would do this, some wouldn't. But I don't know if, I just don't see it as very realistic when you go behind a tree and you can still see yourself. So I kind of want this game to kind of have a realistic feel, or more of an 8-bit feel, I guess, in that sense. So that's why I'm making it so you're, whenever you walk behind stuff, you just can't see yourself. Yeah, Solstice too. Thanks, Artemis. Alright, so yeah, that's it for today's stream. I drew this tree today, and later on I'm gonna work on patterns. So, So patterns, these things are where whenever there's a blank area, it's gonna go and fill it with something cool, a tiny little pattern. So yeah, I'll be working on patterns and more interesting points later on. Ooh, look, another tree. So So yeah, that's it for today's stream, and you guys can catch me again. I stream every day just about at about this time, so I'll be back later on. The best way to follow this stream is to actually follow it on Twitch, because I stream at kind of random times, so it's best to just get notifications. So we'll catch you guys later, and thanks again for watching, everybody.